Do you like games?
I do like games.
Well, excellent, because today we're going to play a game called Quickfire Climate Denial.
Okay, let's go.
Who am I?
You're Dr. Gilbs.
I'm Dr. Gilbs.
We could introduce each other. Hello, this is Ella Gilbert, otherwise known as Dr. Gilbs, but you probably already know that because you're over here on her fantastic YouTube channel.
And this is Climate Adam, who you might recognise from a channel with the same name. Should we get stuck in?
Yeah. Okay, this myth is a good place to start. It's not happening. Two-word answer to that, it is. There are multiple lines of evidence to show that the world is warming.
And it's not just the global average we're interested in. We're seeing a variety of different amounts of warming all over the world.
And it's not just about temperature, although that is what the phrase global warming refers to. We're also seeing patterns of change to rainfall, to extreme weather events, to ice melting across the globe.
Okay, next myth. Climate change is natural.
Okay, so this is one that I think we both must hear all the time, and maybe the form I hear about it the most in is people saying, oh, it's all just caused by the sun. Why didn't you climate scientists think about the sun? So Ella, why didn't we think about the sun?
We did. That's the headline. And actually, natural factors like the sun or volcanoes, which seem to be the one that I always get, they don't really play any considerable role in driving the climate change that we've seen.
Okay, so the next one. Carbon dioxide is only 0.04% of the atmosphere, which is true, but then the logic of this myth is because it's such a small part of the atmosphere, it can't possibly be doing anything big. And as Ella herself has proven, small things can pack a serious punch. Actually, one of my first ever videos was about this topic, and I used the comparison of a very small amount of arsenic in a glass of wine and how you probably still wouldn't want to drink that glass of wine.
CO2 can pack a punch because it drives something called the greenhouse effect, which no doubt you will have heard of.
I think we often talk about the greenhouse effect as if it's somehow new science, but the basics of the greenhouse effect have actually been around for some 200 years. And without the greenhouse effect to explain what's going on in our planet, well, the planet would be way too cold for comfort.
The science of the greenhouse effect may be old, but it's still around because it stands the test of time. We can measure the amount of energy coming in and out of the Earth's climate and essentially look at the Earth's energy imbalance.
And what we're seeing is as we're adding more greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, most importantly carbon dioxide, but there are others as well, that energy imbalance gets greater and greater, which causes the world to heat up.
CO2 is plant food.
Well, like so many of these, the beginning of the point is true. I don't know if you remember high school photosynthesis lessons.
Something osmosis cells photosynthesis.
So photosynthesis is the process by which plants turn sunlight and crucially carbon dioxide into plant food. And so the fact that carbon dioxide is kind of feed of that process, the logic goes, well, surely more carbon dioxide, good thing for plants.
Wait, so you're saying that CO2 is a good thing?
Well, plants need it to survive. The thing is, they also need some other things to survive.
What, like nutrients, water, those kind of things?
Yeah, like those kinds of things, as well as the kind of climate that they have evolved to withstand over the course of many millions of years.
The problem with that is the extra benefits of having more CO2 in the atmosphere are greatly outweighed by the negatives of things like, well, climate change.
Okay, the next one is climate has always changed, which is a bit of a funny one given that, like, sometimes I get comments in the same like minute where someone is like, the climate's not changing, and then another person says the climate's always changing, and it's hard not to get whiplash from comments like that. But anyway, okay, this argument the climate's changed loads before, what's going on?
Well, it's true that the climate has changed a huge amount. I mean, there were periods of millions of years where the Earth was completely covered in ice, and then other periods where the oceans were pretty much at boiling point. I mean, there's one period in Earth's history that was so hot, it's literally named after hell.
Well, given all of these dramatic changes, why then should we care about the climate change we're seeing today?
We humans have evolved to live in a very stable range of temperatures. We evolved in a period that's named for that stability, the Holocene.
And actually around the last 10,000 years, basically the time of all human civilization, the climate has been really pretty stable. So that's what we adapted to. On top of that, if you look at the last natural event of climate change, as we left the last major glacial period, a bit before that 10,000 years, the warming then was around 20 times slower than the warming that we are causing today.
And it's the rate of change that is the real problem, because as things are changing this fast, we just can't adapt to keep pace with it.
What we've done already is outside of the stable range of the Earth's climate, but what we could do tomorrow could be even worse. We could see as much warming this century as we see anywhere in the last many, many, many thousands of years. That's if we don't get our acts together and curb greenhouse gas emissions.
And if you're interested in learning a little bit more about the kind of changes we've seen over the last, I don't know, million years or so, then Adam's got you covered.
There's a clicky link somewhere up here so you can dive with me into the last 1 million years of climate change.
Okay. Climate change isn't a problem.
Oh, that's a relief.
This is like the second stage of denial. If the first stage is to deny that it's happening, then this is like, okay, it's happening, but it's not that bad.
But unfortunately, despite these kinds of comments, climate change is already really serious. So you only have to look at certain things like extreme weather events, things like heat waves, to see that we're already feeling the impacts of climate change today.
Even last year in 2022, you just had to see the kinds of extreme heat and wildfires and floods and droughts that were always splashed across the headlines to see that. I mean, that 40 degree, first ever 40 degree in the UK, coincided with a huge heatwave in Europe that, according to some really recent research, killed around 61,000 people.
And as long as we keep heating the planet, extreme weather events like these heat waves will keep happening and keep getting more severe. We're currently at around 1.2 degrees Celsius of global warming, and even our most ambitious climate change targets see us limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees, something many are already worried might be slipping out of reach.
But no matter how much warming we end up seeing, climate change disproportionately impacts the most vulnerable, those with the least resources to adapt or to move out of harm's way.
And simultaneously to that, the people who have actually driven climate change the most, the countries that are the most responsible for it, are generally relatively easy off in a global scheme of things.
Climate change is deeply unfair.
So this next one is one that you get all the time, and it's people saying, oh, well, I just had some snow in my backyard, so much for global warming. Effectively, it's cold somewhere, so how can global warming possibly be the case? To which I would say, what is the first word in the two-word phrase, global warming?
The thing is, global warming is having an impact across the globe, and although you can see different weather patterns happening from time to time, weather isn't climate, and if we take a big picture approach and zoom out, you can see that all regions on the planet are warming unequivocally.
But that said, that doesn't mean all parts of the world will be hotter than normal all the time. Of course, some places will have cold patches, winter will still exist, and so you will get moments which buck that trend. But what climate change and global warming describes is that big picture pattern.
It's abundantly clear. Climate change is happening, it's happening now, and it's happening everywhere. Ooh, yes, this is a nice one for people who like modelling. Models can't even predict the weather. Why should we trust them on climate change?
So another way of saying this is saying climate change models are wrong. And I always find this funny as a gotcha, because my PhD was about the fact that climate change models are wrong. I think the crucial element of it is that any model is imperfect. The question is whether it is still useful for the things you're using it for. And, well, climate change models have shown themselves time and time again to be really useful.
Yeah, no one is predicting the weather on the 14th of June 2084. No one is claiming to be able to do that. But what we can use climate models for is to tell us something about the big picture. And we know enough about the big picture from past and observed changes to be able to make pretty educated educated guesses about what they're going to do in future.
I think when they're that educated, I wouldn't even call them guesses. They're pretty educated calculations about what's going to be happening in the future. Even so, I think some people might still think, oh, but you know, like even patterns of weather, how can we predict something like that? Well, we do that all the time. If I asked you which is going to be hotter in New York, December or June, you'd be able to make a pretty reliable prediction about that. And in a very similar way, climate change models can predict the patterns of change that will take place as we tweak the climate. Okay, so next one. Greenland was green. And Antarctica is gaining ice. This is a comment I don't really see that much on my channel, but I imagine you as an icy-themed climate change YouTube channel see this one quite a lot.
Yes, finally, some polar myths to debunk.
Greenland was green, why else would it be called green?
Well, it's a bit of a misnomer because, in fact, in somewhere around about the 980s, they think, an Icelandic adventurer called Eric the Red went forth and was trying to entice potential settlers to Greenland by calling it, you guessed it,
Redland.
I guess Iceland was taken.
So, so is Greenland too.
It was Greenland.
Okay,
it was
yeah. Greenland. So there was already big sheets of ice on Greenland at this point?
Yeah, we think that Iceland was already covered in ice. It's been ice covered for, we think, about 400,000 years.
Okay, wow. I hear a slight version of this, which is that in the recent past, there have been certain climate changes, things called the medieval warm period or the little ice age. And these periods did exist, but when we study the history of the Earth's climate, we see that they were localized to specific parts of the globe, unlike today's global warming, which is heating up the entire planet. What is this thing about Antarctica gaining ice?
Well, it's true that some bits of the Antarctic were, well, until very recently, if not in some places still, gaining ice, or at least changing very, very little. Particularly, this comes up when people are talking about the East Antarctic. But if we take Antarctica as a whole, it's very clear that it's losing ice, especially from the West Antarctic and from the Antarctic Peninsula. More broadly, of course, if we talk about the whole of the polar regions, and that's Greenland, Antarctica, and glaciers on land, they're all losing a huge amount of ice, which is adding to sea levels and driving many of our problems.
Oh, I wish there was a really catchy series all about the loss of ice on our planet.
Well, funny you should mention that, because I just made a series with Jason Box called The Biggest Loser, catchy, right?
Yeah.
About all the things that are driving ice loss from the polar regions.
Are you going to put a link up here?
Yes.
Okay, click the link up here.
Okay, so this one is ridiculous. And I put this one in just for fun. So this one, the toroidal apple core Earth black hole sun is waiting to be released. The toroidal apple core Earth is frozen.
By ridiculous, you mean it's funny because it's true. Is that kind of what it's like? That's just
right.
That's
yeah.
Just climate science 101, right?
Yeah, that's the first thing I learned on day one of my degree.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Wow. Well, full marks for creativity.
Yeah, I don't know how to respond to that.
But actually, genuinely, we do get comments like exactly this one when we post videos about climate change. So if you see us making a video and you like that video and you feel like you learned something and you don't believe in the toroidal apple sun, let us know in the comments. It really makes us feel better.
At least some people are out there. Well, that one is quite clearly ridiculous, but one thing that isn't ridiculous is a video that Adam and I have just recorded.
Such a good segue. It's all about the loss of Arctic sea ice, what the future predictions are, and why it matters for all of us all over the world.
And you can check it out somewhere over here.
Okay, bye.
Thanks for playing.
Yeah.